anglais. In 1791, François Dominique de Reynaud de Montlosier, a deputy of the National Assembly, wrote a satirical poem ridiculizing the initiatives of the Amis des Noirs in favor of the emancipation of the gens de couleur. And I quote, les Amis des Noirs à l'Assemblée, qui sont-ils ces juges intègres pour les Noirs si compatissants, les mêmes qui, depuis 2 ans, traitent les Blancs comme des nègres? 2 years later, Germaine de Staël used the same type of analogy to complain about the disdain constitutionalists like herself inspired to royalists. And she wrote, c'est comme les gens de couleur à Saint-Domingue qu'on poursuit jusqu'à la dernière génération. In the 1790s, such comparisons between the French metropolis and the colonies were not new. Analogies of feudalism were a particularly popular semantic pattern to discuss the hardships of colonial slavery and European serfdom. During the French Revolution, and even more during the Restoration after 1814, these comparisons, however, increasingly recurred to racial instead of social categories. Political factions started treating each other as whites, Negroes, or mulattoes. This shift expressed 2 fundamental experiences. First, the slave rebellions in Saint-Domingue, and second, a political vocabulary that became increasingly blurred, ambivalent, and contradictory. As categories such as liberty or royalism or social-political hierarchies lost their distinctiveness, they could be used by all political sides. Racial categories then provided a seemingly unambiguous political language. Colonial and racial analogies thus provide a fresh perspective on the discussion triggered by Susan Buck Morse's reflections on Hegel and Haiti, on how aware 19th century Europeans were with regard to the conditions of colonial slavery and the Haitian Revolution. Moreover, the semantic field of race struggle is a well-known feature of liberal French historiography. In the 1820s, authors like François Guizot or Augustin Thierry interpreted France's political and social landscape as a divide between deux peuples or deux races, between ultra-royalists and liberals, nobility and bourgeoisie. But rather than making explicit use of a colonial background, they located the origins of these race struggles in medieval times that provided a setting for an oppositional discourse otherwise restricted by censorship. Regarding statements like those I quoted at the beginning, the question though arises about whether the aftermath of the Haitian Revolution also marked patterns of social antagonism despite the alleged colonial oblivion. I will unfold my argument in 4 steps. First, I look at how French actors try to make sense of the Haitian Revolution in terms of European categories. Though this attempt failed, it second provided the Haitian side with the opportunity for inverting this comparison to uncover post-revolutionary France as a society marked by domestic racism. In a 3rd step, turning back to Restoration France, I'd like to demonstrate how French authors adopted this racial pattern in turn, and I discuss how much Haiti we might trace in the 19th century de France when we overcome a Franco-centrist perspective. And I finish by an outlook about how racial analogies became depoliticized after the Revolution of July in 1830, but still fueled debates on the abolition of slavery until 1848. During the Ancien Régime, comparing social conditions between the metropolis and the colonies was a persistent topic in colonial discourse. Whereas its opponents argued that the reform of feudal privileges in France should lead to substantial improvements of the slaves' living conditions, its supporters evoked the paternalism of slaveholders to denounce peasants' and laborers' misery in Europe. With the outbreak of the revolution, these colonial comparisons gained momentum. Opponents of colonial hierarchies denounced the planters' aristocracy de la peau to call for political emancipation of the gens de couleur. Reformist pro-colonial lobbyists, in return, suggested replacing slavery by serfdom for maintaining the plantation system. Some even feared negative consequences of slave emancipation on the working poor in Europe who depended on the colonial commercial ties. One paradoxical effect of the entangled revolutions in France and the colonies was that French revolutionaries tended to interpret the Haitian Revolution in terms of counter-revolution. As the slave rebellions remained unthinkable as a revolution on its own right, they explained it by royalist agitation. As a consequence, the military struggle of the Republican troops against the insurgents and intervening British and Spanish forces found its equivalent in the Civil War in Western France. The concept of colonial Vendée, as Malik Gacem has brought out, permitted Republican planters to denounce the upheavals as a clerico-aristocratic conspiracy, as Paris Republicans did with regard to Western France. Comparisons were possible between metropolitan and overseas provinces, nobles and slaveholders, thieves and plantations, sans-culottes and gens de couleur or petits blancs. The underlying idea of rebellion and revolution as an uncontrollable process turned out to be more than a semantic game, as it also impacted on war strategies. As an example, the French Directory sent the general Edouville to Saint-Domingue, and Edouville was a Vendée veteran who should apply his military pacification tactics to the colonies. Opponents of the revolution in return metaphorically colonized the revolution in Europe by referring to themselves as slaves or Negroes. The increasingly blurry distinction between colonial subalterns and their own political marginalization paved the way for using explicit racial categories in the political language. Such ethnic metaphors deepened an already established political division as a struggle between two races, as it put the émigré journalist Jacques Mallet-Dupin, and I quote, "L'Europe se trouve partagée en deux races d'hommes, celle des propriétaires et la race des spoliateurs tricolores commandée par le directoire français." Thus, the declaration of Haitian independence in 1804 took place in a discursively connected Atlantic space. On the one hand, the colonies could be Europeanized in the search for pacification tactics. On the other hand, European political cleavages could be racialized in order to denounce political enemies. Yet these connections were a by and large one-sided operation by the Europeans. After Napoleon's downfall, this situation changed profoundly. The two Haitian leaders, King Henri Christophe in the north and President Alexandre Pétion in the south, saw themselves confronted with the restored monarchy's neo-colonial ambitions. The two regimes counteracted the menace of a French expedition aiming at re-establishing French sovereignty and some type of neo-colonial social order by a propaganda offensive. The wave of Haitian publications after 1814 targeted a transnational audience to foster Haiti's recognition by the European powers. On the level of political discourse, the Haitian side took up the established analogies between Europe and the Caribbean, but radically inverted it. In response to the French practice of applying metropolitan categories to the colonies, Haitian writings denounced the quasi-colonial structure of post-revolutionary France. As France's neo-colonial policy in the Haitian perspective only marked the first step to a more general restoration of the Ancien Régime, Haitians presented their nation as the only successful case of revolutionary regeneration. Whereas France and Europe were plunged into repression by revolutionary convulsion and war, Haiti consolidated her liberty. Despite their internal rivalries, both Haitian regimes shared into this post-colonial critique of the French Restoration. Nonetheless, their discursive strategies reflected their different social composition. In the north, largely dominated by black elites, discursive analogies revolved around slavery. In response to ex-planters' projects to re-enslave large parts of the Haitian population, North Haitian writers suggested slavery as a social condition for the French post-revolutionary society. And they also insisted on the shared extremism by French ultra-royalists and ultra-colonists. The Southern Republic, dominated by Jean de Couleur, skin color became an argument of the post-colonial writing back towards the ancient metropolis. When the French commissioners offered the Haitian leaders to assimilate them to the status of whites by lettres de blanc, as Louis XVIII had assimilated the Napoleonic noblesse d'empire to the noblesse ancienne of the Ancien Régime, President Pétion declared that the French Restoration had introduced a domestic colonialism. For him, political allegiances in France evoked racial categories. And I quote, quant aux hommes de l'Empire, ce sont les mulâtres de la Restauration, implying that French society basically consisted of white nobles or royalists and black commoners or republicans. For Pétion, French Bonapartists were consequently treated as race proscrite. In Restoration France, memories of the Haitian Revolution and Haitian attempts for recognition were far from being completely silenced. This was partly due to French abolitionists and liberals, and also partly to the resonance of the Haitian propaganda initiatives. Liberals such as Simon de Sismondi or Rémusat, and more radical republicans such as Abbé Grégoire and Civique d'Augustine took up the Haitian critique of Europe or reflected themselves on colonial remnants in post-revolutionary French society. Grégoire, a fervent supporter of the South Haitian Republic, drew again analogies between the colonial aristocracy de la peau and Europe's noblesse des parchemins, and assimilated European serfdom to slave-like conditions. Sismondi, a liberal economist from Geneva, reactivated the Vendée analogy in an inverse direction with explicit references to the Haitian writings. The Haitian proofs of civilization made him wonder whether France's agrarian, royalist, and Catholic periphery rather resembled to an inner French colony in need of emancipation. In 1814, comparing Haiti and the Vendée, Sismondi drew a pessimistic outlook for certain races within France. And I quote, ces braves paysans de la Vendée sont sans doute égaux pour le moins toute autre race française. Et bien qu'on les suppose séparés pendant 20 ans, isolés comme l'ont été les nègres de Saint-Domingue, peut-on croire qu'ils auraient profité de cette réclusion pour étudier et faire des livres? In 1833, he gave himself the answer to this question with regard to the inhabitants of Brittany, using a language quite similar to defenders of slavery. I quote, des hommes qui ne savaient ni lire ni écrire, qui ne parlaient point le même langage, qui n'avaient aucune habitude ni d'essence, ni de propriété ni d'ordre, qui semblaient n'avoir d'autre goût que l'indolence et la paresse. Besides such socio-economic considerations, colonial analogies also served as an argument to draw a parallel between the ultra-colonists' revengeful racism with the ultra-royalists' intransigency towards the liberal opposition. The view on post-colonial Haiti reminded Gastine how little had changed in the reactionary worldview of his political opponents. Rémusat, who had written a play titled L'Habitation de Saint-Domingue, made clear that he primarily used the Haitian Revolution for speaking about contemporary France. Liberals like him were particularly concerned that the metropolitan social classes, and to some extent races, behaved like their former colonial counterparts, with the gens de couleur and the classe moyenne as their respective victims. What was the discursive gain of these racial semantics? A crucial figure to an answer is Montlosier, whom I have already quoted at the beginning, but who is rather to be situated on the political right. In the 1790s, after his mandate in the National Assembly, Montlosier had emigrated to London, where he edited several newspapers and wrote on colonial slavery. He was also a confidant of Pierre-Victor Malouet, who represented the refugee planters from Saint-Domingue with the British government, and who, as minister for the colonies in 1814, was the initiator of the neo-colonial mission to Haiti. This colonial dimension in Montlosier's political imaginary has often been overlooked in scholarship on his multi-volume work De la Monarchie Française, published after 1814. Like many other Frenchmen, Montlosier complained about the post-revolutionary confusion about political concepts that had taken so many contradictory implications that they became unsuited to express divergences unambiguously. Therefore, he focused his work on historical antagonisms between Romans, Franks, and Gauls, between nobility and third estate, in late antiquity and the Middle Ages, he called la lutte entre deux classes. In the literature on early 19th century French historiography, Montlosier therefore figures between 18th century authors writing on the origins of French nobility, such as Boulainvilliers and Dubos, and the liberal historians around Guizot and Thierry in the 1820s. They all shared the same trame épistémologique of historical knowledge, as Michel Foucault called it. Within this trame, Montlosier is often presented as one of the early representatives of the idea of De France, albeit he rather took sides with the nobility than with the liberal left. In the Monarchie Française, we do not only find analysis of Restoration France grounded by historical examples, but also allusions to the Haitian Revolution and to Haitian writings. For example, Montlosier explained the dualism between nobility and third estate at the moment of the Restoration in France in Haitian terms. And I quote, "Je suppose que, fatigués de la situation actuelle de Saint-Domingue, ils viennent à la pensée de quelques grandes puissances de le rendre à son souverain légitime et qu'elle en fasse la conquête. Quand se présente un prince français allant siéger par capitulation dans un sénat mi-parti de blancs et de noirs, si ce sont les Noirs qui l'emportent, je tremble pour notre prince. À la première restauration, cette fable s'est réalisée. Par la conduite qu'ont tenue alors les puissances, les Noirs se seront trouvés avoir une telle prépondérance que la victoire a eu lieu sans combat." Beyond the otherwise historical setting of social combat between the deux France, the fable of racial metaphors provided him another language to essentialize tensions in French society. It is a commonplace that historians of La Jeune France in the 1820s operated with what Foucault called a réversibilité tactique du discours with regard to Montlosier. Essentializing the antagonism between nobility and third estate, they took sides with the latter, justifying their liberal claims against increasing ultra-royalist aspirations. What is significant, though, is that both Guizot and Thierry not only reversed Montlosier, but also replaced his category of class by race. Was this a mere discursive shift relying on a usage pattern that since the Middle Ages semantically linked race with royalty and later nobility? Or do we also need to take a post-colonial look on Guizot's essay Du gouvernement actuel, where he acknowledges to have borrowed his conflict thinking from Montlosier, or on Thierry's essay Sur l'antipathie de race qui divise la nation française, even if Haiti is not mentioned here explicitly? Indeed, there exists an immediate link between the two opposing camps regarding racial semantics. In 1818, we find it in a review of Montlosier's work in the Censeur Européen, edited by the liberal economist Jean-Baptiste Say, that applied Montlosier's racial fable to the French social order in general. And I quote, "Un gentilhomme, comme on l'a vu, est un roturier, ce qu'un blanc est un noir. Cette comparaison établit en faveur du premier sur le second une supériorité incontestable. Elle prouve sans difficulté que nos seigneurs, les gentilshommes légitimes, sont nés pour commander et se reposer, et que nos autres noirs illégitimes, nous sommes nés pour travailler et pour obéir." Given the fact that Guizot and Thierry had close connections with the Censeur Européen, I would argue that also the historical writings of these authors contain a subjacent subaltern point of view with a Haitian background. When Guizot speaks of la guerre entre deux peuples and Thierry of dualité nationale, this suggests that they had not only in mind Franks and Gauls, lords and peasants, nobles and commoners, but also whites and blacks or masters and slaves, as Montlosier had. Such categories fitted with the liberal interest in the racialized dualism both in French history and contemporary society. When Thierry asserted that Montlosier had substituted, and I quote, "à l'idée de classe et de rang, celle de nations diverses qui applique à la lutte des classes ennemies ou rivales le vocabulaire de l'histoire des migrations de peuples, des envahissements territoriaux et des conquêtes," these categories would well apply to the Atlantic space. Montlosier, at least, was fully convinced of such a colonial subtext in liberal writings. When Guizot reverted Montlosier's antagonist social model, The letter left no doubt about the illegitimacy of this liberal interpretation. So Montlosier wrote with regard to Guizot, tout le mal est dans un petit nombre d'êtres rangés dans vie, espèce mulâtre qui, n'étant ni noir, ni blanche, ni noble, ni peuple, ne veut pas être rangé dans la classe populaire et ne veut pas se proposer pour la classe noble de peur de n'y être pas au premier rang. Montlosier stuck to his Atlantic analogies also after the Revolution of July, when slavery-related issues gained far more attention than in the 1820s. More generally, analogies of race and slavery in the 1830s and 40s showed two tendencies. First, after the recognition of independence in 1825, Haiti gradually lost its taboo character, but only to fall from widespread silencing into partial oblivion. Nonetheless, a conservative journal like the Journal des Débats could now call the Révolte des Canuts in Lyon une espèce d'insurrection de Saint-Domingue. This leads me to the second observation, namely that semantics of race and slavery during the July monarchy fueled broader debates on social and political reform similar to Britain and the USA. Besides the established analogy between slavery and serfdom, slavery and race also became interpretative categories for the living conditions of workers, soldiers, religious groups, or women. Like the divergences between Montlosier and the liberals, these analogies, Eurocentrist as they were, could have opposite implications depending on which group was seen as the real slaves. Whereas the economist Eugène Buret, as well as Montlosier, argued that industrial workers in Europe were treated as badly as colonial slaves, if not worse, Paris workers protested against such assimilations, insisting on their personal freedom and calling for slave emancipation. The socialist Louis Blanc emphasized that at least workers and industrialists in France belonged to the same race. In 1848, the definite abolition of slavery seems to mark a break in the discussion on the racial and colonial character of French society. An abolitionist like Victor Schoelcher could integrate the past struggles into a universal process of emancipation that, from a Republican viewpoint, made further debates on who was the real slave or Negro obsolete. I quote, toutes les libertés sont sœurs. Le peuple français, en s'émancipant, devait émanciper ses esclaves. À peine installé, le gouvernement provisoire abolit la servitude comme la royauté, comme tous les restes de la barbarie antique qui souillait encore nos codes. And I come to a brief conclusion. Post-colonial semantics of race in post-revolutionary France add an important dimension to the debate on of the long-term consequences of the Haitian Revolution on Europe in terms of conceptualizing social antagonism and political conflict. The references to a revolutionary Atlantic space partially confirm Michel Rolf Trouillot's thesis of a silencing of the Haitian Revolution, as well as Sibylla Fischer's observation that the silencing rather took the form of disavowal. But the case of analogies draws our attention to yet another mode of reception, namely a semantic transfer from the Atlantic space to Europe. This transfer owed little to a declared interest in post-colonial Haiti, though Haitian writers actively contributed to the debates, but was rather driven by its multiple functions for the French context. The crushing colonial order provided a political language for making sense of inner French social-political antagonisms that neither revolution nor restoration could dissolve. This observation calls for a post-colonial perspective on early 19th century debates, but also for a certain skepticism towards recent scholarship that has made new attempts to legitimize an engaged interest in the French Revolution by presenting 1789 as post-colonial founding experience for France herself. As writes Pierre Cernat about what he called l'année de l'indépendance des Français, la révolution est non seulement une guerre d'indépendance, mais surtout et en soi une décolonisation en marche. This view is certainly suggestive in its use of metaphors, but also astonishingly unaware of its likeness to 19th century discourse. So historicizing these metaphors by relating them back to the appropriations of upheaval and regime changes helps us to better understand the entanglements between the different theaters of revolution. On a semantic level, rather than decolonizing an inner French empire, the Atlantic revolutions triggered colonial awareness in France herself. Thank you very much for your attention.